faculty, you can introduce some thing about us. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But I don't know, will we be able to hear Razvan if I am the one streaming?
What would be the problem with that?
I don't know, I thought you ought to be on the live stream as well.
I can quickly check.
No, I disabled the stream, so I can see the stream, so you are streaming, Stefan.
Alright.
I'm also doing a recording, a local recording on my side, such that we can have a second copy if anything goes wrong with the live stream. Or are you using OBS yourself, Stefan?
Yes, OBS.
Yeah, okay, so maybe when you start to do, you can also do a start recording. That will mean that you can also have a local copy of it.
Okay.
So you can also click start recording.
Okay, I'll start recording right now.
Mm-hmm, awesome. All right, so that being said, howdy everyone. We are here with Stefan. Stefan has been part of the Unikraft project for quite a while, for 2 years, and he's been working on the memory mapping API/virtual memory part. And today the aim is to share you some of his experience, the ups and downs, and some of the technical things he went through as part of his work there. That being said, Ștefan, you have the floor. Enjoy.
Thank you very much, Răzvan. So I am Ștefan, as I already presented. I worked on the virtual memory in Unikraft, and I will be holding a presentation about this. It will be a pretty technical presentation, so brace yourselves. I'm going to start first with definition, so to say, of virtual memory. Why is it? What is it useful for? And just a note: all the examples that I'm going to give throughout the presentation are for the x86 64-bit architecture. But it's worth noting that most of these details also apply with very little changes to other architectures, such as ARM 64-bit, for example. Now, what do we use virtual memory for? It is a memory management technique. So we use it to manage the physical memory or the hardware resources that that we are given to for the operating system. And we do that by using virtual addresses, which are managed by the kernel instead of physical addresses. Virtual memory also provides an abstraction to the hardware, so we need not be aware of we need not worry about other applications' memory, because we are running in our own virtual address space our application, and we do not need to worry as it was in the old times, in the MS-DOS times, when you could crash another application by writing in the wrong memory because everything was in the same address space. So as a consequence of this, everything is properly isolated, and this also helps so it's not that we need not worry about the other application's memory, but we cannot access other application's memory unless we are given explicit permission to do so. And there are mechanisms to do that, we will talk about later. Next, virtual memory is useful for creating an illusion of a very large addressable memory. For example, let's say a usual device might have 8 or 16 gigabytes of memory. However, using virtual memory, applications running on that device can have the impression that they actually have terabytes or petabytes of accessible memory. They can use addresses well beyond the interval 0 to 16 gigabytes. And for the x86 64 architecture, this limit is 256 terabytes. Now, a bit of terminology about all the terms that I'm going to use. A frame is a fixed length continuous block of physical memory. So when I say physical memory, I'm talking about the real hardware random access memory that we have in our device and is used. A page I don't know, do you also see the presentation? I'm seeing a pretty weird thing because of the streaming. It overlaps with the previous slide. Okay. A page is a fixed length continuous block of virtual memory. So the distinction is important between these because a page can map to only one frame. So a page in virtual memory refers to one frame, but one frame can be referred to by multiple pages. For example, some operating systems may do the following optimization. They notice that a file is open and mapped by multiple processes at the same time. This file doesn't need to be loaded in memory several times just because multiple processes are writing to it. Instead, it is only loaded in the physical memory once, but mapped to multiple processes. And these pages, again on the x86-64 architecture, can have these sizes: 4 kilobytes, which is the regular page size, and 2 megabytes and 1 gigabyte for larger pages. These sizes might seem arbitrary at first, but they are not. The 4 kilobyte one is the usual choice for multiple hardware vendors because it provides a good balance between not having too many pages and not wasting memory through fragmentation. For example, if the page size was 1 megabyte and I needed 1 megabyte and 1.5 megabytes, I would have allocated 2 pages and I would have lost a full 0.5 megabyte. Okay, now a page table is the data structure used by the virtual memory to store these mappings. So whenever a translation needs to be done from a virtual address to a physical address, we do it by looking at the page table. A page table entry is a mapping between a page and a frame, is an entry in the page table data structure. And apart from holding the physical address, which a virtual address is mapped to, it also holds other information such as the mapping state, which can be: am I allowed to write to this page? Am I allowed to execute whatever is on this page? Is this page dirty, which means has it been written to since it was last validated by the cache? Is it present in memory or not? Now, to talk about page tables themselves. How are these actually implemented in the hardware? The simplest model would be to have just one table that keeps all the correspondences between all pages and all frames. And it would look like this. We have all the pages on the left and all the frames that they map to on the right. Now, for a 64-bit architecture, for the case that I have chosen, the maximum virtual address space the maximum size of a virtual address is 48 bits. This is hardware dependent, so this number might vary. For this example, we have 256 terabytes of virtual memory. Now, to map all of these individually, there are two problems. First, we don't have 256 terabytes of physical memory on most devices. So from the start, this is a complete waste of space because not all of this table will be used. Now, if we assume that this were the case, and if we were to use this table, it would waste 515 gigabytes per process. So each process needs to have a page table, and each process would need to store this very long list of all the mappings from its virtual address space. So this is not a good solution. What the hardware vendors came up with as a smart optimization for this was instead it has a hierarchical tree-like structure. What does that mean? It means there are 4 levels of page tables. There is a root page table, which is stored which its physical address is stored in the CR3 register. And from this root page table, we navigate or we traverse the other tables to get the physical addresses of the next table. And then once we reach the table, we will get the physical address that we are looking for. One table is exactly the size of a page for convenience. And the main important difference between this and the single whole list is that tables are only allocated when necessary. So this tree might not have all the leaves, only the leaves necessary to represent the pages that are currently mapped. And to translate an address, the time wasted is not that much, because instead of traversing one table, we traverse at most four tables, which is acceptable for the amount of memory that we saved. Now, I can't give you an exact amount of memory, how much this takes, because it's heavily dependent on what is running at the time in the operating system and how it chooses to manage its own memory. But this solution is a lot better. And the leaves of this tree contain the actual frame, or the actual page table entry corresponding to the page that we want to translate. And now we're getting into the real low-level stuff. This is how an address translation is actually done. So what happens here? Here on the top is a virtual address. It has 64 bits, and it is divided into these areas. Now, you will notice that every level of page table has a name. These are not important for us. Not even I know their names by heart, so we'll just ignore them and refer to them as level 1, level 2, level 3, and level 4 page tables. Now, whenever we want to translate an address, what happens? We take this first set of bits, so there are 9 bits here that we take. We take the address of the root page table from the CR3 register, so this is the physical address, and the CPU looks at that address, it finds the root page table, and the offset within that table contains an entry that points us to the next level 3 page table where we need to look for. So we take the next offset from our virtual address, the next 9 bits, we look at this offset in the L3 table, and it will give us an address for the level 2 table, the beginning. Now we know the beginning address of the level 2, we know the offset from here, we look here, we find the last level of page table, we look in this table at this offset, and now we have our physical address. From this last table we get the frame, but now we want to look at, so the frame is 4 kilobytes size in this example, but if we want to look at the middle of it, for example, these last 12 bits are the ones that point us to that half, and this is the actual physical address where the CPU is going to look and retrieve the information. This process is completely transparent to even to the operating system and to the user, because we just tell the CPU, load what is at this virtual address, and the CPU does this. Now, a page table entry has this structure. Again, it has 8 bytes or 64 bits, and it has, as I said, the physical base address, but it also has other useful information. There are some bits here. In order, this is the present bit, which says, is this page actually in memory or not? Now you might wonder how can it not be in memory? Well, it cannot be in memory if it is swapped, for example. A swapped page means that we keep its page table entry because we still want to access it through the virtual memory, but instead of it being in memory, it was swapped to the hard drive. And whenever the application wants to access that page, the hardware will generate a page fault, which means, sorry, I can't find this in memory because it is not present. So the operating system knows, okay, I need to search for it on the disk then. It searches for it on the disk, it loads it in RAM at the correct address, and then it sets the present bit to true, and the application can continue running. This bit is the writable bit, so we know we can write to this page. This bit is a user or system. These are related to caching, write through, and something else. This accessed bit tells us if this page was accessed, since it was brought to the cache. And this one, if it's dirty, if it was written to, since it was brought to the cache. Because if a page is in the cache but it is not dirty, all cores can read from that page and it will be fine. But if it is dirty, if one core has written something to that page, the other core, depending on the cache policy, might or might not need to know. So this bit tells the CPU actually if there was a write on this page. And again, this is done automatically by the CPU. No one needs to do anything to fill this bit. This one doesn't matter. This is the global bit. For example, it is used for kernel pages because we want them to be mapped everywhere in all page tables. We don't want the kernel pages to be invalidated if we're changing the CR3. These are user available bits. The address, again, some user available bits. And these bits are for technology specific from Intel called memory protection keys, which are a really interesting piece of technology that we actually use in Unikraft for a research project, FlexOS 2, and they are used to isolate pages even from within the same address space. Usually from one address space you could access everything that is mapped in your address space, but with memory protection keys you can't do that. And this is important in Unikraft, and we will see why in a moment. So this was the most low level part of the presentation. Now we're doing a short recap before going to Unikraft. So the virtual memory translates virtual to physical memory, right? The process is completely opaque to applications. Applications have no idea that this is happening behind their backs. They just run, and each application feels like it's running with the whole memory available to it. Page tables facilitate this translation. They have the hierarchical structure that we discussed about for low memory footprint. Page table entries give us the information on how to find the frame for a page. And now we can go to Unikraft. Now, Unikraft and other unikernels as well run only one process. This is the main feature that defines a unikernel. And being library operating systems, the kernel and the drivers are linked together with the application in one binary. These two particularities mean that we can map everything into one single virtual address space. So we no longer have the separation as traditional operating systems have, that where they need to separate different processes or separate the kernel from the application. Everything runs in the same address space. So now you might wonder, why not just completely disable the virtual memory? Because everything needs to run in the same address space, we don't need all of those features that are mainly used for providing this isolation. Well, first is that Unikraft is a POSIX-compatible operating system. This means that it needs to be able to run applications written for other POSIX-compatible operating systems that might expect virtual memory. For example, the mmap function family, where there are the functions mmap, munmap, mprotect, and so on. So applications might expect this. I need to modify my own address space and map this file here at this address for my application to run correctly. So we need this in Unikraft. Next, some drivers need virtual memory for their correct operation. For example, some hypervisors provide some optimized virtualized driver implementation, for example, Vert.io from KVM, or other features such as Xen Store used for implementing drivers in Xen, where the guest OS is required to create virtual mappings for specific addresses to access the features provided by the hypervisor to ease the implementation of drivers. Next, on the x86-64 architecture, 64-bit programs, which run in the CPU being in log mode, which means 64-bit, cannot be run without virtual memory. So the CPU does not allow entering log mode without enabling virtual memory. So if not for virtual memory, Unikraft could only run, or any other OS for that matter, could only run 32-bit applications on an Intel x86 CPU. So we know we need to keep virtual memory, but we still have the advantages Unikraft has by being a unikernel, which is that it's mapped in the same address space as the application. So we have some pros. There are no context switches that we need to make. So whenever there is the scheduler does a preemption, we never need to switch to another page table. Everything is in the same address space. There are no cache invalidations whenever a context switch would have been made, if there were, to mitigate all the vulnerabilities that showed up in the last years. There are no system calls because everything is just an ordinary function call. The application code can just jump wherever in memory and execute the code from there, even if it is kernel memory. So the kernel only manages one address space, so the code is easier to write, to maintain, and is cleaner and more lightweight. But there is also some bad things, of course, with this model. Applications can read or write the kernel memory, which may or may not be a problem. The worst thing that an application can do is crash the kernel, which is a virtual machine, so unless there are vulnerabilities in the hypervisor, there shouldn't be any problems. And as a consequence, applications can influence the whole address space without any, so to say, any limitations from the operating system. In Linux, if we wanted to modify our address space, it would work as long as the operating system allowed the application to. Here, you can just modify the page table however you want. It may or may not crash the application. Now, because Unikraft is usually run as a virtual machine through a hypervisor, there is one more thing that happens in the hardware, which is a second layer of page tables. Now, why does that happen? It happens because the hypervisor runs on top of the hardware and it needs to manage multiple virtual machines at the same time. So it also has its own virtual memory, but its virtual memory is the guest's physical memory. So whenever a translation is done, the guest's virtual address, which becomes the guest's physical address with the translation that we have seen earlier, this is not a physical address. This is a virtual address for the host or for the hypervisor. So another translation has to be done again to actually get to the real hardware physical address And in the past, this was done in software by the hypervisor through a technology called shadow page tables, which was really slow. But in the last years, this has been optimized by being implemented in the hardware through technologies such as EPT, or extended page tables, on Intel, or NPT, or nested page tables from AMD, which do this translation in the hardware. Now, Unikraft can run on these two hypervisors. It can run on KVM, and KVM is the type of hypervisor where guests run fully virtualized, meaning they are not aware that they are not running on real hardware, except for virtual drivers. But apart from that, they expect everything that you would expect from real hardware. So they are not aware of this second layer of translation, because this is only used in the virtualized case. So this second layer is handled by the hypervisor. There is absolutely no need for the guest to know that there is a second layer of page tables. On Xen, on the other matter, which runs the guests para-virtualized, meaning guests know that they are virtualized, and as such, special code has to be written, more optimized code might be written, knowing that it is being run in a virtualized environment. And one of these optimizations is that the guest can directly manage this second layer of translation by writing, by completely getting rid of this middle by this middle translation. From guest virtual, we go directly to host physical. Now, usually this would be a security problem, because if the guest can access the whole host physical memory, then it could just access other virtual machines' memories. But fortunately, the Xen hypervisor does not let guests do that. So a guest cannot directly write into page tables, which is a particularity here. Instead, all updates to page tables must be done through hypercalls. And hypercalls are an extension, so to say, of system calls. Instead of calling the operating system, the guest is calling the hypervisor, and the hypervisor does this. So this is how Unikraft, this is what I have implemented for Unikraft, for taking care of the virtual memory, and I have achieved a lightweight API, as I mentioned earlier, that should only take care of one address space, is optimized for this usage, so there are no other extra features to handle multiple processes. The road is open to implement these. What I did was easily extensible to cover this use case, so multiple page tables can be created if needed. But this would break the unikernel contract, so to say. And I did this for both KVM and Xen hypervisors for the x86-64 architecture. This was my main project in Unikraft. And yeah, thank you. This is everything that I wanted to present. Now I think it's question time, if we're not out of time.
We are fine with time, Stefan. Thank you. One question I'm not sure if it was clear for everyone. You mentioned the requirement for virtual memory and the fact, okay, you have mmap and you have all those Xen store and the items. Why wouldn't a simple mapping, I mean, a very dumb paging mechanism that simply maps the same virtual address to the same the virtual address to the physical address not work? A one-to-one mapping, but via page tables.
So this
because then you would mmap would just return, okay, a virtual address, even if that is behind the scenes a physical address.
Yes, so you can never know what you can expect from an application to do with its memory. For example, the POSIX standard includes the map fixed flag for mmap, which allows application to map wherever they want in the whole virtual address space. This is one example. Second example was where you might want to map more pages to the same frame. For example, for memory mapped files or other type of I/O. For example, PCI devices where you can map them to the virtual memory. So these are features that are needed to maintain not just POSIX compatibility, but to make it useful for all sorts of applications that might need them.
Yep, makes sense. Thank you, Stefan. Any other questions? So this is kind of a very in-depth OS class. So once you go into the virtual memory and memory courses of your OS class, this is we should do Stefan's slides for this is the missing page table lectures. If there aren't any other questions, we thank you, Stefan, for your talk. And can we also have access to the slides to make them available to anyone who wants to?
Yes.
I mean, I think that it's valuable information for people to look into.
Sure. Yes, I'll make them available.
Right. Awesome.
Okay.
So yeah. So Alex, maybe you can stop the live stream. Yeah.